But if you have your Bibles, will you journey with me to the book of Exodus, the 14th chapter? Exodus, the 14th chapter. Exodus, the 14th chapter. One of my trustees texted me, amen. Exodus, the 14th chapter, starting at verse 10. We're going to skip up a little, and we'll see what the Lord has to say. Exodus, the 14th chapter, I'll be reading from the New Revised Standard Rendering of God's Word. It reads as follows. As Pharaoh drew near, the Israelites looked back, and there were the Egyptians advancing on them. In great fear, the Israelites cried out to the Lord. They said, Moses, was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us, bringing us out of Egypt? Is this not the very thing we told you in Egypt? Leave us alone. Let us serve the Egyptians, for it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness. But Moses said to the people, do not be afraid. Stand firm and see the deliverance that the Lord will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to keep still. Then the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward. But you lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the Israelites may go into the sea on dry ground. Then I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they will go in after them. And so I will gain glory for myself over Pharaoh and all his army, his chariots and his chariot drivers. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I have gained the glory for myself over Pharaoh, his chariots and his chariot drivers. We're going to skip up to verse 21. And it reads, then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind and night and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites were into the sea on dry ground, and the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them, all of Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and chariot drivers. After the morning watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and cloud looked down upon the Egyptian army, and he threw the Egyptians' army into panic. He clogged their chariot wheels, so they turned with difficulty. The Egyptians said, let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them. Then the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand over the sea, so that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and chariot drivers. So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea returned to its normal depth. As the Egyptians fled before it, the Lord tossed the Egyptians into the sea. In last verse, the waters returned and covered the chariots and the chariot drivers and the entire army of the Pharaoh that had followed them in the sea. Not one of them remained. I was taught in seminary, if you have a long text, you have a short sermon. Amen. 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 Let us pray. God, we thank you for your word. I ask that you bless us, God. Hide me that people can only see you and hear you. In Jesus' name, amen. In your hearing, I just want to talk for a few moments as we celebrate our pastor, 30 years of pastoral leadership. I want to speak from the subject, the Lord will never let you down. The Lord will never let you down. Some of you may be saying to yourselves right now, I don't know if that's a fully a true statement. Because there have been some times in your life that you've been faced with some difficult situations. Sometimes the difficult situations may not go the way that you wanted them to go. But I'm going to tell you, they went the way that God wanted them to go. You may have lost some things and lost some people. Some things you wanted to keep and some people you wanted to keep around. However, God allowed that to happen because that was a part of the journey for you to get to where you are right now. Maybe you're saying to yourself, but I'm not where I want to be. But may I remind you, you're not where you used to be. I don't know who I'm speaking to today outside of Dr. Marriner, that he never thought he would see these 30 years of ministry. But I'm quite sure as he looked back over his life, he can say that God has been good and that God has never let him down. But here we find ourselves perusing the book of Exodus. In my opinion, Exodus is a very interesting book. This particular book is one accredited to be written by Moses. The very name of it alone is a testimony. This book is part of the Pentateuch and falls in the historical category of the Bible. However, the truth of the matter is that Moses was testifying in his writings. He was testifying about how God provides for his people. The word Exodus in its Grecian translation means a way out. So not only was Moses testifying that God providing a way out, but he was saying that God can make a way out of no way. As you continue to look at the text, you can see that it looked like there was no way out. We all know how that story ends, but Dr. Merritt, if I was at New Genesis, I promise this would have to be at least a three-part sermon series, because to fully receive Moses' testimony, we have to revisit his birth and how Pharaoh was killing all the Hebrew male children born to control the population because of his fear of a Hebrew takeover. This reminds me of the birth of Jesus, when King Herod wanted to kill all the boys that were of a certain complexion that were two and younger in fear of Jesus taking his throne. This lets us know that the enemy was up to the same old tricks. Better yet, speaking existentially, the enemy is still up to the same old tricks. He's trying to take some of us out with certain issues that we have. He's trying to take some of us out by certain people we encounter. But the truth of the matter is, God is up to the same old tricks as well. God is up to the same old tricks because he keeps providing a way out. Whoever would have thought that a man by the name of Melvin and Marriner would emerge from a small, dusty area called Bowers Hill. It is amazing what God can do with someone who others count out. God has a way of counting on them. Is there anybody here that experienced some people that said you would not make it to where you are right now, but God had a different plan? God had a different outcome that would not be of those who said that you would not make it? I'm quite sure that you can catch Pastor. He spoke of my private moments, but you can catch him in some private moments that he would testify about the many times that the enemy tried to abort this 30-year moment right now. But God, oh, I thought I was at a Baptist church. But God, I believe that we got at least 600 or 700 people in here that can look back over their lives and thank God and give God some praise, knowing that God made a way out. I know that may sound cliche, but the thing about it is the truth, that God provided some way out for all of us when we did not think we would make it out of what we were in. But here in this text, we see the children of Israel, who were once happy residents of the province of Egypt, but are now running from a place where happiness and freedom used to be. They are running from a place where happiness and freedom is a thing of the past. Under a different Pharaoh, Joseph had favor. But another Pharaoh rose who did not know Joseph and decided to put his people in bondage because of that fear of losing power. Some leaders can be territorial and insecure. Thank you, Pastor Marriner, for showing me what healthy leadership looks like. In the pediatrics of my faith, I saw Pharaoh as just being a mean person. I saw Pharaoh as just being an example of bad people. But the truth of of the matter is he did not realize those were not his people to control. And in all actuality, these were God's people. I got excited right here because I realized that God would always protect us from people that are like Pharaoh. I've learned that you have to love God's people even in challenging moments. There are times in our life when the enemy is being persistent in our downfall. In church, I come back here to tell you when such times occur, just know that the Lord would never let you down. As we continue to survey the text, we see that the children of Israel are running. They're not just running, but they're running for dear life. I don't know if I'm in the midst of the right people, but is there anybody here that ever found themselves running, but you were not just running, you was running for dear life? There was something that was lurking from your past. There was someone that was lurking you from your past that decided one way or another, I'm going to bring you down. I don't know what it is that you was running from in your immediate past. It might have been some credit problems, might have been some financial problems, might have been some enemies, the people you've gotten into it with. Whatever it was near and close behind you, but somehow God provided a way out. In order to see how God provides a way out for you, the text is telling us three things that we have to do. The first thing the text is telling us is that we cannot panic. So whatever you do, don't panic. Don't panic in moments like this. Sounds hard to be done. But just in case you panic, just know that we have a leader that will stand on our behalf and talk to the Lord. Don't panic mean panic is actually an overwhelming of fear, an overwhelming fear that takes over you, that you do not know what to do but cry. The text tells us that they cried out to Moses, why didn't you leave us where we were? Were there not enough graves? Were there not any graves in Egypt? Moses, did you bring us out here to just die? I must say, after 6 years of pastoring, I know how it feels to sometimes have to deal with when the people are complaining. They're saying, Pastor, this is going on in my life. Pastor, that's going on in my life. But what do I go from here? But I'm so glad we have a leader like Moses, Marriner, that does not panic in situations like this. But the second thing that goes on in the text is that Moses realized that he had to pray. I know some of you may be saying, nowhere in the Bible does it say that Moses prayed, but I think some of us have forgotten that prayer is just having a conversation with God. Prayer, oh, like my grandmother used to say, oh, can I just have a little talk with Jesus? Is there anybody here that's glad we have a pastor that does not mind still having a little talk with Jesus? A pastor that still does not mind staying in consistent conversation with God. Church family, you have to keep people around you that don't mind talking to God. You have to keep people around you that will pray, but it's so important to be under a leader that will pray for you. But lastly, as I make my way to my seat, I told you I won't gonna be long. The last thing we have to do after you don't panic and you pray is you have to remember the past. Remember means to recall from your memory everything from your past. Look back every now and then and see where the Lord has brought you from. There would be some people that tell you you should never look back because you're not there anymore. But I must admit to you, every now and then I find myself looking back. But when I look back, I see some sad stuff. And when I look back, I see some horrific memories. But I'm so glad I look back because there are reminds me through everything I've gone through to get to where I am right now. You might not can get excited with me, but if you look back over your life and see all of the hell and high water that God has brought you through, I'm going to give you some time to think back. Just think back to the last time that you was caught up in a hard situation. Think back to the last time that the enemy was gaining on you, but God caused the way out. Think back to the last time that God had to step in on your behalf. I thought I was at New Genesis. I thought I was in the midst of some folk at Grove that's able to give God some praise because they know now that God will never let you down. I know you may be going through something right now, but if you look back, you'll see that trouble don't last always. Is there anybody here that can testify that trouble don't last always? I'm sorry, church, I'm getting ahead of myself. I know I said that I was about to take my seat, but I can't sit down yet. I can't sit down yet because I found myself, as I continue to read, I got excited. I got excited because in seminary they taught me about this thing called kerygma. So I see the text as being more kerygmatic now. Some of y'all are like, what you talking about? But I got excited because I started to see Jesus in the text. Some will tell you that Jesus is only in the New Testament. But if you read the Bible careful enough, if you read the Bible close enough, Jesus has a way of always showing up. Oh my God, the text says right here that the children of Israel, when Moses raised his hand, in other words, he gave them praise. So when Moses raised his hand, it says that the waters parted open and the children of Israel crossed over on dry ground. Yeah, all of us heard things like they don't look like what they've gone through. They do not have any residue from what they've gone through on them. But I see this right here as being Jesus. What are you talking about, preacher? The only way we can get out of what we used to be in is that Jesus has to be offered to us. Oh, you ain't got it yet. But here, God is parting the ocean, parting the sea, saying the only way to get to me is through Jesus Christ. So the truth of the matter is in the text that the parting of the water represents Jesus Christ. Maybe that didn't work for you, but I read somewhere in the New Testament where it says that the veil was split in two. Whenever God is about to bless you, he has a way of splitting things open so you can get close to him. Is there anybody here that serves God or can testify that God split some things open that was not supposed to happen? I'm almost done. But I got excited because I realized why Moses didn't panic. I told you earlier that you have to look back and remember, recall some things. But Moses didn't panic because Moses was used to God making some water miracles. Amen. What are you talking about, preacher? See, when Moses was a kid, his mama put him in a basket and he floated up the river. But God had provided somebody there to pull Moses out. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but if you look back over your life, you'll see that God has placed some people strategically in your life. God has placed some people that he has his hands on, so they're able to put their hands on you. But on the day, I'm not talking about all those people, but on the day, I'm talking about a man by the name of Dr. Melvin Orlando Marriner, who God blessed us to follow and follow him this far. And God wants us to keep on following him. So if you're here today and you've been blessed by God to know Dr. Orlando Marriner, I need you to stand to your feet. Every now and then God will give us moments like this to remind us of good, how good God really is. I'm not saying that Dr. Marriner is our savior, but I am saying that God used him to get us to where we are right now. I'm excited today. I should be crying, but I've learned that in difficult moments is when God truly shows up. Mama gonna be all right. God's word had to go forth. But on the day we celebrate 30 years of pastoring people, it's not easy to lead complaining people. I ain't talking about you, I'm talking about me. I remember the many calls, the many text messages, me complaining. As I read this text, I saw you all in the text. I saw myself in the text, and I'm glad that I saw our pastor in the text. Good leadership. Someone worth following. Someone that will pray when we panic. And someone that helps us recall our past. He was preaching to me and didn't even know it when he talked about my past, and that's what it is. And as he said, my right now is much brighter than my past. But so was yours. Don't be afraid to look back and recall what God and see what God has done in your life. Don't be afraid to tell people what God has done in your life. I should have had the title as being God Would Never Let You Drown. All of us have been in some drowning situations that the water just rises, the hell just rises. But as I said before, God provides and made a way out. So I must ask the question now, is there anyone who does not know this split in the road that God opened up for you called Jesus Christ? Yes, death is on your left, death is on your right, and death is behind you. But if you go read in your leisure, you'll see it was an angel that went before them. I told you this should have been a three-part sermon, but this ain't where I preach at every Sunday, amen. But if you go read the text, you'll see that angel was a representation of God before them. And that alleyway they went through to get to God is through Jesus Christ. Oh, it still doesn't make sense to you, but the word of God says that you must come to the Father. The only way you can come to the Father, it must be by Jesus Christ. So is there someone here today that's willing to make their way to the Lord? Death is beside you and behind you. But on today, you say, you know what? I'm going to choose the Lord's way. Because if the Lord got me to this moment, even though the Lord may not be in my life, the Lord didn't let me down. Who is God speaking to today? The Lord didn't let you down. He didn't let you down. You may be thinking right now, but you don't know what I'm going through. I'll say right now, you don't know what I'm going through. But I know the Lord won't let me down. The journey is what builds your faith. The journey is the place where God tests and tries you. And you come out stronger than you were before you went in. Because if you go on and read the text, I'm saying, y'all got to do some Bible study when you get home. It says that they believe God and they fear God. So believing in God is fear of God. But maybe you're here, you already know Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. However, you had a moment that you took yourself off the throne, took God off the throne and put yourself on the throne. And you might have gone back to some old ways saying, God, I got it from here. But somehow, some way you ended up back in the Lord's house today. And you say, you know what, Lord? I need to put you back on the throne. Lord, I want to get myself back right. And the only way I can get back right is you, God. So if you're here today and you found yourself in what Jeremiah called a backslidden state, I know many say that that is very negative, but it's a positive, isn't it? Because it says that God is married to the backslider, which means that God will never leave you even when you leave him. Ain't that something? I'm sorry, y'all. I'm just talking Bible. Or maybe you here, you need a church home. I joined here October of 2001. And I must say to you that it's a wonderful place to be. So if you're here today and you need a church or a place to call home where you can open a refrigerator called the Word of God and eat freely that bread of life, which is Jesus Christ, you need to come on down right now. So lastly, he offers salvation, reconciliation, and a place called home. Is there one? Is there one? Well, remember, when the enemy is behind you and the water's before you, remember, don't panic. Pray, and you also have a leader that prays. And remember the past to see what God has done in your life and what God has brought you through.
Thank you for joining us for today's message. If God is impacting your life through this ministry, join us in reaching others all over the world by investing today. You can give at grovechurchva.com/giving. And don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel for more messages like this one.